One of the major contributions that Dinis has made to OWASP is something called OWASP Open or OWASP O2.
O2 Platform, eh? OWASP Open, you still remember that?
I remember that, yeah. So those of you who remember OWASP, so this is why it's called O2. Yeah, it's an amazing tool for you to scan your code. And recently, of course, it's been doing a lot of work on Node.js and JavaScript and some really, really interesting stuff. I have to warn you, Dinis speaks very, very quickly, but I'm pretty sure you will understand everything. So, thank you, Dinis.
Thank you. So actually, just on the topic of the random thing, right, and you actually asked, so this is actually a test I wrote recently, because I had exactly that question when I was doing a code review, and I found random. And I actually wrote a code comment to the developer saying, random doesn't generate random numbers. And I kind of went for lunch and came back and realized that is probably the stupidest game you can ever write, because it's so obvious that, you know, it makes sense. So then I decided to actually do a bit of research, and I found this cool API, and I was able to actually basically prove that given two seeds, I'm actually able to replicate. And the other thing that's very powerful in this, and I'll go back in my presentation, is that we should be communicating with tests. So when I give these developers, I'm giving them these tests. Say, hey, run this. Don't believe me. Run it. And you can see that I'm going to generate one random, get two values, get another two values from that guy. I'm going to call my replicated random, feed the first two, and I'm going to assert that after that, my new hacked random, my next two values are going to be the same two values that I got from there. Right? For me, this is science. This is what we should be doing. Right? In fact, what pisses me off from the piece of presentation is that we need to move on from this thing that we're kind of hacking away this stuff. Right? It's like, it's beyond that. I get to the point where if I need to do a black box, I'll just punch the client, right? Because that's pointless, right? We need, you know, there's so much stuff to do that we don't have time to kind of screw around with, you know, kind of being politically correct and try to hack the things, right? But that was my rant for today, right? So now moving on to stuff. So I'm going to do two presentations. And I think for the first time, I'm actually not going to do a demo. Well, I have some stuff I can show, but I think I have time. So the first one is actually more on topic, which is Node.js. So, you know, and the second one is, I think, a really powerful solution that we have to develop really powerful ways to test our apps, but it's also in Node.js. So first of all, yeah, to me, I've been coding for a long time, AppSec for a long time, like my day jobs. I do stuff, I do AppSec teams at HUD, EDC, I build AppSec teams, if you're an AppSec team, talk to me, right? That's kind of what I still do. There's my blog, there's my thing, there's my LinkedIn, some books, right? I did these recent presentations with my like, right? And that one has like another 200 slides, so they tend to be reasonably big these days. But the main thing to take out of this is, first of all, I'm getting to the point where I can really measure I can use application security to define and measure software quality, which is really interesting. Because I'm yet to define a developer team that doesn't want quality. And I think with AppSec, we are touching that, because we can measure it. It's all about how you define quality. So I get to the point where if you can't refactor, that's a risk problem. It's a security problem, because you can't change fast, right? The main thing is, this is what I call modern application security. If you're not doing this stuff, you're not even playing the game, right? And basically, this is kind of the stuff which is also quite important, is we need to stop talking about technical debt. I think pollution is a way better analogy, right? So you can see that presentation. The other thing is, this is the key to unlock, you know, the kind of the pit of despair of the back, the backlog stuff, and this is how you get people to actually pay attention to security, is you create a risk workflow like this, and then you give them a nice little button, right, for them to click risk, right, and this is basically you making sure your boss gets fired, he makes sure his boss gets fired, until you actually reach the CTO, because that's the thing, that's when it becomes real, right, and that's what you need to capture, because you need to capture reality. So you have a SQL injection, you have a great massive vulnerability on your app, cool, that's a feature. You want to fix it? Great. Accept the risk, right? So you're playing this medium-term game. The other thing that I presented recently, and I always freak out developers when I say that you have to always write passing tests. So it depends how much TDD you've done, depends how horrified you are with that or not, right? But there's a really cool concept around it, and the whole idea is that when you write a test on the fixed state, you are focused on fixing the bug. When you write the test on the issue creation phase, you actually focus on how to test it and actually how to actually be able to find this root cause. And it's very different, because you're going to find all sorts of gaps in the test infrastructure. In fact, the solution I'm going to give you on the second part of this can only be addressed at this stage. Because here, when you're fixing the bug, there's no way you can say, oh yeah, sorry, I need another 4 days or, you know, 24 hours or something like that to improve my test infrastructure, right? That's just not going to fly, right? Where at this stage, we can say, hey, guess what? I cannot replicate that bug. So I can go and fix it. You're going to have to accept the risk that my fix is going to be a whack-a-mole, because I cannot replicate that bug. So that's a much more interesting game. So let's talk about Node.js security. Basically, it's just as good as bad as .NET, right? It's kind of like, literally, we still do the same, but as a security, we haven't really evolved that much. It's kind of frustrating, right? You know, for the guys who've been doing this for a long time, you kind of would say that you get to the point where, oh, we can just strike that dude off the list, right? Just we can't. We haven't learned a lot of lessons, but at least we're building bigger and faster websites, right? And, you know, we have a lot more horsepower and basically an assets. So basically, this is like the first part. And if you know these books, right, for the guys who know JavaScript, you probably know those little books. The book on the left is the JavaScript, the book on the right is the JavaScript, the good parts, right? And so basically, there's a lot of great stuff about JavaScript, right? The first one is native JSON, which is very important for anybody who done any kind of JSON programming, .NET, Java, PHP, whatever language, you know, it freaking doesn't work, right? You're always shoehorning, it's always a horror story. There's actually a huge amount of performance problems that can be trying to get JSON into .NET, or Java, right? You might as well freaking use JSON because, you know, Node is already there, right? They're already optimized. Google has spent gazillions of years to make sure that thing runs almost as fast as assembly code. It's crazy fast. You basically have a V8 engine underneath there, which is crazily fast, right? It's a sync, which is actually very, very interesting. It's one of those paradigms that once you start using it, you really want it. And I've seen a lot of cases where you put this Node in front of a Java app, and it's great because the Node app will scale like there's no tomorrow. You're just blowing up the Java app left, right, and center because the Java app has no way that can handle the kind of traffic that your Node app, which is in front now, can handle. Now, if you use a Node app to protect the other one, that's a really cool idea. If this guy becomes a proxy, that's kind of a problem, right? So the other thing we do is we have one, that's event loop thread, which again freaks you out until you get your heads around it, then it makes you kind of threading looks very interesting. I really like the new Go, the thing of Go routines, that's quite interesting, right, in that kind of world. But I think the Node and the JavaScript model is also very, very well. Works very well. It's highly scalable, scales very well, it's developer friendly. There's a very fast development loop. You have basically, does anybody have a mouse? Sorry. Oh, okay. I can borrow. Because this guy is like, can you guys not hack? Does anybody do gang stuff here? And we have another one. Oh, without your mouse. Yeah, well, I'm just saying that this guy's not going quick enough, right? And so the other thing is that it's very developer friendly. It really enables CI and CD in continuous deployment, right? Because you can tell the difference, right? You can absolutely tell the difference, and hopefully this doesn't have rubber ducky on this thing, right? And basically, cool, right? There you go, that's more like that. But now it's just here. So, and also, yes, yeah, script scratch is pretty good. There's a lot of stuff you learn. But I actually like CoffeeScript. Happens to be my favorite language at the moment, right? And just because it has a really cool combination of simplicity and functionality and power, and I can code crazy fast. I really like things like Jade because it's HTML templating, so suddenly you cannot have cursor scripting unless you kind of shoot yourself in the foot, but it's very easy to detect. And things like TypeScript, a lot of innovations. Right, again, there's a lot of innovation, pure open source child, we like great stuff. I think the fork in IOJS was really, really powerful because .NET and Java deserve one of those, right? Because I think Oracle and Microsoft would have done a lot of things differently, well, said at the time, if somebody had said, hey, you guys are really screwing up over there, we're going to fork it over here, right? And that's basically what IO was, and then, of course, they realized, let's actually join the thing together and Node is much better, especially now that IBM bought, I think, the main company behind Node, which is probably better now, it's a bit more safeguard. There's some crazy innovation. Node.js security project is very good. SSL is actually quite easy to do, enterprise ready, massive sites. There's some great tools out there, very container friendly. It's very good to create microservices, which you get into. Testing development is part of the culture, and also there's a growing security maturity. Things like Node checks on file paths, which were there on Node 0.6 or 0.7, now are fixed. They actually are taking security much more seriously. This is Wallaby. If you guys don't use Wallaby and code JavaScript, you are basically ridiculously crazy because this is the only way you can program in JavaScript these days. Unfortunately, the IDEs have not realized that they need to provide an environment like this. So hopefully one day IntelliJ or Visual Studio will like buy this guy, right? Or just rip him off, doesn't matter. But this is the environment, right? And the environment is basically an environment where you basically program and you have an environment like this. So you have a situation where you basically are coding and you lift your hands and the test fails, right? So you can see this is actually one that maps lots of my attack surface. As soon as I type that, the test runs. I can see exactly where it fails. I can see the code path. I use the code coverage to understand it. I get the errors, right? This is how you have to program. If you can't program like this, you're not doing test-driven development. It's that simple. Right? So, and if you're a manager, you have to demand that your developers code like this. If you're a developer, you have to make sure that your manager demands that you code like this, right? And then you have to code it like that. In fact, these days I like to give the analogy that if you don't code using tools like Wallaby and others or equivalent, because what you do is you hack your own way if you don't use Wallaby, it's like going back to SVN well after you've done Git, right? So it's kind of the same thing. So just to be clear, right? I really like JavaScript, so before the next part, which is the bad bit, right? I really like, in fact, Node.js, as long as cheap as Wallaby, is my most productive and enjoyable dev environment. And this is actually, I think it's very interesting, because I had a crazy development environment when I was doing the stuff in O2. So the O2 platform gave me a spectacular development environment where I could do stuff that you cannot even do with Visual Studio, but this just tops it up, right? Which is kind of why I'm now more in this world and on some of the stuff there. But I'm merging the two projects, right? So yeah, there you go. So I basically easily write secure code, 100% code coverage, right? So what's bad about JavaScript and Node? The same old top 10. We have to work hard for our secure app, not in the box, cross-site refresh rosary, for example. You have to work hard. REST injection actually cannot be as bad as SQL injection because everything is a proxy, right? Model binding is still nice and alive because people sometimes take the thing and invite and do those objects, and so easy to do this in JavaScript. And again, it's freaking JavaScript, which is not strongly typed. They have some crazy type. You know, this is where JavaScript actually goes a bit off the rails, right? There's some crazy freaking type conversions in there, right? This decimal conversion, like I had that the other day, was like, really, you're kidding me, right? In 2016, you can't freaking handle a decimal, right? Nope, you can't, right? You can override by prototypes, other APIs, which is even crazier. So if you thought Java was bad because you could override classes along the class path, well, Node.js takes that to a completely new level, right? Every single NPM that we import can override everything else that came along, right? So pretty ridiculous, crazy, and very powerful, by the way. You know, the project I have at O2, it's called Fluent Node, abuses that. So it goes both ways, right? So it interprets code, so strings can become code, which, and by the way, eval and save queries can lead to recode code execution. So there's strings everywhere, and by the way, we have to ban strings, right? Just kind of dropping down there, right? There's no place in your code for a string, i.e. there's no place in your code for a 4 gigabyte monster of just about everything that Unicode can handle. So we need to ban strings. There's actually a great post by John Wylander on that thing. And what I see a lot in Node in this pattern is a proxy to internal systems. Which is great because the internal guy says, hey, I'm internal, nobody touched me, except that the dude in front of you is literally just proxying the request. He takes the data, massages it a little bit, and sends another one right to the internal network, right? So you might as well be connected to the internet. NPM is crazy and mad as Maven, NuGet, CocoaPods, and all that jazz, right? Very little security checks performing new models. There's not a lot of security eyeballs. There's some stuff on Node security, blah, 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 you know, those guys. There's also some new companies like SourceClear and a couple of others that are trying to kind of get into this space. But again, if you look at what's inside some NPM messages, some of it's crazy, right? There's this guy who pick into it and there's like some crazy stuff into some NPM packages, right? Because again, there's very little control of what's there. A handles will crash the server. This can be a good thing or a bad thing, right? It's a good thing if you run in a nice disposable environment within containers where you have hundreds of node instances running. So it's like the idea versus the cow versus the puppy, right? I think you gave me a different one, right? It was the puppy versus the horse or something like that, right? On that analogy, right? But it's like the idea that you have a puppy, you look after it. If you have a herd of cows and the thing gets sick, you just kill it, right? Because you have 10,000, right? You don't want to care about it. So our servers should be the same thing. If you don't care about your server, this is great, right? If you care about your server, this is a problem because your site will go down, right? We do a lot of server-side HTML JavaScript generation, which is not good. Sends a ton of SSS, right? Secure coverage is really hard. We can't visualize. This is kind of pissing me off because we should have be better now. This is the stuff I was trying to do 10 years ago with outstops and the static analysis, and we still don't have good support for this kind of stuff, right? We should be thinking in graphs, we should be thinking in AST, we should be thinking about code paths, visualizing code completely different. We still have these freaking flat files, right? Which have nothing to do with reality, right? So, again, right? And we still don't have limited support for sandboxing. So I don't know if anybody from Microsoft or remember Microsoft or use C#, right? But the thing they really got right was code access security. That was probably the best thing they did for security until everybody ignored it and then Microsoft ignored it. So we went back to running everything with every privilege. So it was a massive missed opportunity. But in terms of controlling access, code access security is a really brilliant piece of concept and technology, right? Except that not a lot of people use it. So you can't do static analysis very well. NoSQL databases are crazy for injection attacks. Express has things supports like for this, which is pretty crazy. So I've seen cases where you can put a payload on an express route and it thinks it's only one thing that gets converted to a URL, which now gets what? It's going to be used for a REST call internally, right? So actually IIS and the Apache actually did this because they would normalize the request before it hits Express. Express says, I'm not normalizing everything, right? If you want to forward slash, which is what that is, in your whatever variable name means in the middle of your URL, that's fine, right? But just be careful what you do with that kind of stuff, right? And I'm sure there's more stuff on it. So that's kind of Node.js. We still have all this, right? Basically, the whole freaking thing is there. You'll find it. And basically, I highly recommend this project, the OWASP Juice Shop, because it has a really cool, a scoreboard and all kind of stuff. The way I would do this, if you don't have a lot of time, is to actually use the white box approach. So basically, especially developers, you say, look, have a go, and then look at the source code, and then exploit it. You know, that's cool. Then you can do it in a couple of hours, right? Or else somebody will be lost, right? It's good for us, but, you know, it's kind of like, or capture the flag competition. But if you're doing training or something that you have to focus, just get them to the source code. Node code is another one, which is quite cool. And actually, I would highly recommend this book, right? For node security, right? Just get that book. It's pretty good, right? And basically, you should, final thing is know the risk of your application. So here's, for example, this project. Actually, if you are into OpenSAM or vSIM, this is a pretty cool project to visualize the whole thing. I'm coding this. What I'm doing is basically I'm using GitHub labels, and I basically have every single security issue and risk that this application has. So this is everything that currently today that application has. And I don't view this as a problem. I view this as features. I view this as I'm able to allow whoever uses to make good decisions and know what needs to be fixed and what is the state. So I don't worry about a project that has this stuff, all these issues. I worry about a project when you say, hey, what's your security risks, what's security concerns? They say, we don't have any, right? That's the one I worry about. Because this is when you map stuff. This is reality, right? And you want to capture. And every one of these stuff is features, right? That have security implications, right? So, okay, I'm not going to this. This is the vulnerability I found. I want to get to the other one. Basically, it's a case where, you know, I do a thing where I save files, and then there's I wrote the test to prove that, and then I wrote the test for the nano service, and I wrote the test for remote code execution, which is there, and then there's another one for CoffeeScript, and then this is the first fix. There's a regression for the fix. And then the part of this, which I just want to relay to you guys, is that these days, what I do is I do this. I use comments to communicate with developers. So in fact, look at that, 19, 20, 23. Now, you know, it's going to be 24, 25, 26, because some have been fixed, some have been addressed. For example, we have now this, but there's a resilient one. But even then, after I've done this, in the last month, I already found a couple of others, right? So you keep track of it. And all these are accepted risks, right? Because that's the behavior of the application. The ones I fix were the ones I agree that, oh, actually, I should fix that thing, right? Maybe I should have remote code execution on this thing, right? But the other ones are stuff that I'll accept because it's okay, right? So there you go, right? That was the first one. So, the big problem I always had, right? And it's funny because I remember when I created O2 Platform, my kind of big vision for the O2 Platform was how do you automate security knowledge and workflows, right? You know, it's all nice and good. If you do security, you can own stuff, you can find problems. The biggest problem is how do you communicate? How do you transmit? And that's why I arrived at the idea of writing scripts, which write O2 Platform for on steroids. Then I arrived at the idea that doesn't scale, I need tests. So then I go into tests. So that's why tests for me is so critical. But there was a very key piece of the puzzle, which I never really kind of cracked, was how do I create a system that dramatically creates an environment where the developers want it, we want it, and we can do stuff that the developers can't do at the moment, and we're going to work together. So I arrived at this thing called surrogate dependencies. And the idea is that when you're coding, you shouldn't mock code. You shouldn't mock functions. You should say, oh, I'm going to call this function, and that function is going to call three others. Who cares, right? That's not the point. If I call this function, I want something to happen, and I want to check that something. So what you really should be doing is mocking your external dependencies, mocking your queues, mocking your web services, mocking whatever you use. That's what you should do. So this is a tool to do that, right? So what you have here is basically, okay, you go, that doesn't matter, right? So basically, surrogate is basically a substitute for that between another person. There's an interesting thing on kind of surrogate models in engineering. And by the way, I'm still kind of playing with the surrogate name. I kind of was going into proxy, delegate, so surrogate kind of fits a bit the bill. So let me know what you guys think about that one. And basically, it's an API. It's a system to test the API that you use and replay the answers back. Right? So what it is we use integration tests to lock the API. So what happens is you then save that as JSON and then you replay back to the client. Right? So, and this is the magic sauce, right? This will allow the clients, the APIs, to be programmed offline. And what it means is, if you have a developer that is coding without this, their productivity will go 5x. I usually say 25%, because people already think that's too much, right? But it's crazy off the charts when you do this, because suddenly you don't have dependencies. Suddenly you don't care about the current environment, and you have a much aligned model between what you're coding and the environment that you have. For us, from a security angle, this is where we're gonna put our abuse cases. So we'll take the happy paths, and we are given, right, on the plate, all the things. If you look at 90% of what you do as a security tester, is you are creating the artifacts that this will give you for free. It's that simple. You are mapping the traffic, you're understanding, you're visualizing, right? All that stuff. If you give me one of these, you get it for free. And this is where that massive great synergy exists, right? So this is how it works, right? So this is a client, goes to the network, calls the API, and goes back. So now that client can be a mobile, a web service, a user, right? Another service, so whatever. Basically, you have two entities talking to each other, right? What we're gonna do is first, we're gonna run some integration tests that will hit that API, and we'll store the data in a Git repo. Very important, because JSON is a great language to store. You start to get great benefits. It's easy to refresh, it's easy to understand, it's easy to diff. So there's a lot of great stuff you can do with it, right? So that's the first segment. This is already golden, right? Very few teams have this. Because what you're doing here is you're telling these guys, the client, exactly what they use here. You're telling these guys exactly how they are used. Right? Which very few people that develop APIs have any idea how their APIs are actually used. This gives you that on the plate. So just this is very worthwhile doing. The problem is, every team is so busy, right? So they never have time to do this kind of stuff. So we have to add a bit more. What you do with those JSON files is, we're now gonna run the same client, but instead of going to the network, we go to the server dependency. We hit the Git repo, we modify the data, optional in the beginning, and we give it back to the client. The client now is running offline, right? This is actually beautiful, right? You guys do that, there's a moment you go, whoa. But first of all, it's crazy fast, right? Because there's, you know, this now happens in milliseconds, right? And you have this crazy environment. So suddenly your tests can run in milliseconds because you just eliminated the hard dependencies. You eliminated the thing that takes time. And the key of this is you still run the full suite of tests when you go back into the QA department, and eventually you might find some blind spots, but because you're also running the previous one all the time, this guy should always be fresh with new stuff, with new things. You can also use version control here, which basically means that you can work on the next version already before even the service supports it, or the other way around. You can say, hey, I still can't support the new version of the data, let me continue to work on this, and eventually I'll catch up. So there's a huge amount of great workflows that you can do with Git on this one. So from my point of view, from a security angle, what you're doing now is we're gonna take this stuff, so remember integration test, Git repo, right? And we're gonna put the payloads here. So this is the first part of the test. So we now wanna test this guy, right? And we were just given on a plate every single way to talk to this guy. So we put our payloads in here to attack, So we put our payloads there to attack this guy. Again, this is very powerful because we have all the state to do this. And by the way, you should do this with tests anyway, right? This shouldn't be done manually. This is all done with tests because it means it's replicable. So this is we attacking the server. What you also do is you attack the client. So what you also do is you take that structure, which is basically the client, the network, and the server dependency, we put payloads there, and we find vulnerabilities on the client. So what we're doing is we're saying, hey, what happens if your mobile app, what happens if your web app, what happens if your service A is attacked from this other service, right? Because very few people, when they're coding here, think like that, because it's a trusted source. I trust that, it's my company, right? It comes from my thing. Right? And basically, here's the interesting thing. What kind of issues have you found this way? Well, I found cross-site scripting stuff, SQL injection on some mobile devices or local storage. I found cross-site request forging to the server. This is the best one, because usually this guy has a really nice token, which basically means he has access to everything the user does. So what you do is you get some data that goes here, which is going to be used into a REST call, right? So now you can see that the server goes back, calls saying, hey, give me all my accounts, right? And in the account name, actually says, oh, my account name is Dinis, /... /... /... right? account /transfer/ from this. And it gets even better if the server side has this thing called method override, which a lot of services do, which basically means that from a get request, you can go to a post, put, or delete. Right? So suddenly you go from one little thing, you take total ownership just from that little request that you put in. Right? And the denial of service is great, you can crash that guy left, right, and center, and also steal session tokens, which is very valuable. Right? And this is all, this is basically, is the server attacking that guy. Right? So once you do this, is, so once you know where the client is vulnerable, i.e. once we know what kind of data points, i.e. you want a full list of every single string, it's always a freaking string, right? That you can actually put payloads in, you go to the API, and you can, you ask them, hey, where did that data come from? Right? And then, you know, after they even realize, you know, what that question means, they go, whoa, I have no idea, right? So now you do the reverse here. You start to chase. Oh, you know that field that you just rendered over there that the client is not able to do? You know that URL or that HTML that we're rendering in a nice web view that have a connection to the Android or the iOS thing that blows it up or runs on this JavaScript? Hey, that came from Reuters. Nice, right? So some dude in Reuters can now put some JavaScript that will compromise every single customer that you have. Really cool. Right? And then you, it gets nice because you then go into real world, which looks like this, right? You go, oh, I got that from that guy. Oh, I got that from that guy. And they come from that guy. Oh, I batch import that from some translators, right? That gets from that dude over there who gets it from a spreadsheet, right? And that over there is supposed to put in translation, right? Suddenly that ends up on the client, right? But with this, we're doing science. We go bit by bit, layer by layer, and then unit test all the way, right, until you find the thing, right? So that's the model. You follow the rabbit holes, and if you find one that takes the attacker, you have an exploited vulnerability, right? So that's how this works. Now there's one extra module that I'm adding, which is basically this thing where you can actually do a proxy. So you can start with a proxy, and I already have an XSS proxy, so I'm using it for this. So the idea is that you make a request, it's in the cache, if it's not, I go and load the data, you save the data, you put it on Git repo, load the data again, modify the data, send the data to the user, right? So it's the next request, if it's in cache, he hits yes, and then you do the thing. So this allows you to kind of build that thing and go offline sooner. I quite like the unit test approach because you go layer by layer and it's much more solid. But this is a nice way to shortcut the kind of creation of the offline material that you kind of need, right? And it's very powerful. So let me just show you a quick demo for that. So this is basically an app that I was working on, right? And this is from IG. I don't know if you guys know IG. It's basically a trading company. And this is basically their app working offline. And on the left, you see my proxy, right? So what you have here is, now there's two key informations here, so this is already in my video, you can see that I'm offline in my video, right? And I'm gonna play this, so I go to test, I can't log in, I go to UAT, I can log in, right? I go there, it's actually very quick now because everything is running, see, no internet connection, right? And you see, now I can get to use the app, blah, 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 the full app is working, you actually get to see the request submits there on the left, so you can track the whole thing, right? And basically it's quite interesting because you're now running the full app in kind of offline, and then you can do all sorts of stuff. And now this is an interesting case because in this one, you'll see in a second, one of those payloads coming through, right? So in a second, pop in the market. So I go to the next one, I go to my one, and there it is, right? So this, I don't know if you guys can see it, but this guy here, it's /..............................................................................................................................................................................................................................................................�. To the backend and call that with the token that exists here, right? So that's a good example. And this guy's running offline, right? This gets the developers really excited and gets us really excited because we now can see exactly what's happening. This, for example, is the one that I didn't implement. There's a 404 there, right? But we can now put payloads on every single one of these, right? Which basically makes a massive difference. So that's how it works. So why, you know, kind of why do you want, so what's the problems that developers have? There's a fragile dev and QA environment, they do very inefficient TDD, right? They have lack of production-like data, this is massive. There's a lot of companies that they don't have good data to run their tests, right? You know, and sometimes it's security, but sometimes it's just, there's enough data variation, they don't have enough tests, that they don't have kind of, you know, good data that simulates real user data, right? They can't work offline. There's a huge amount of manual testing, and I think devs and QA should be banned to use a mouse, right? Because they shouldn't be able to click on stuff. And I'm a dev, right? So I'm speaking as a developer, right? You should be able to do everything you would a test. If you can't do it a test, it's a problem with your test infrastructure. And there's actually very good science on this, because we as humans are really bad at switching context, right? So if you're coding in a zone and it's running, you're flying. It's like, you know, you're running, right? You're in this groove, right? Even if you eventually have to loop over here, it's fine. It's in your own time, right? If you don't do that, you have to make a code change, go here, click the click, goes there, and then click the click, and then wait, and then click the click, and go, okay, that didn't work. And then you go back, make some code change, trigger deploy. If you're lucky, that's more than that's less than 10 seconds. Some people's like 30 seconds, blah, blah, blah. So it's totally crazy, right? You know, and meanwhile, you lost your mojo, you lost your thing, you do something, you go to the internet, you browse, you go to Stack Overflow, whatever, right? And this is why it's crazy performance. So it's the difference between having development loops that last seconds to development loops that last 30 to 40 seconds while losing your mental model. Right? So that means that you can do maximum 30, 40, 50 development loops in a day, where when you're coding in that speed, you do that in an hour, right? It's crazy off the charts productivity, right? And we, security guys, should make the developers of that, because guess what? They become your best friends, right? And they do a lot of great stuff for you when you have to go, hey man, let's put SSL on this, right? I know it sucks, right? I know it doesn't matter for anybody, but actually, we should do it, right? And then they have time for you, because you earn their respect, right? That's what you want to do. And this is massive, right? There's a huge versioning problem everywhere. You have these frozen APIs, you have these APIs that are freaking salads, right, of methods, because they can't reverse, they can't change it, they can't version it, right? And it's a massive freeze of stuff, right? We can solve a lot of those problems. There's this crazy weak schema contracts, which is kind of why you have strings everywhere, because nobody really knows what a postcode means. Right? Nobody really knows what an ID, what that thing. Oh, I just put a JSON string in there, right? Eventually some dude will validate this, right? And so that we have a big problem. There's lots of bugs. I was working on a system where we had a warehouse that literally crashed for one character, because eventually that thing ended up on something to print. And guess what? It was corrupting the printing thing, so the FedEx dude or whatever we were using couldn't get the printing. So guess what? Literally the packets were piling up, right? And it was one character, one address, right, that gammed the whole thing. Right? So remember that string thing? And this is quite interesting, right? And this is another great controversial topic, right? String, you know, we shouldn't call it a type. In fact, we shouldn't call string strongly typed, because it isn't, right? An int is just about strongly typed, right? You know what it is, right? And by the way, most of the time you don't want ints, you want uints, right? Because a lot of places negative numbers don't make any sense, right? But those things are reasonably strongly typed. A string, it's a freaking blob, right? We should call it blob, right? Because that's literally what it is, right? A pile of stuff, right? Because that's what it is, right? And the solution is you create strongly typed classes that on the setters you do the validation, and then you can handle how it gets saved, and it's much, much nicer that way. And you have very, very clean interfaces. And if you complain about performance, I would argue that there's way worse places in your code for performance than doing that stuff. And it would dramatically clean up your code, right? And there's very few people that have dedicated microservices for the application, which it's actually what we created. What we created with that thing is a microservice, or the beginning of a microservice for your application, right? So this is the key, right? I view that for AppSec to work, we have to make the devs more productive, right? If we are attacked, they don't deal with us. Because of course, you know, why would they, right? The best description I heard from developers saying, hey, we neutral, right? Now we deal with so much shit, so many people, that we're just pragmatic, right? You guys are just one of them, right? It's you, the network, the bosses, that dude, and that dude over there, and the testing, and QA. Hey, we just do our best, right? So if you make them productive, if you do find synergies between us and them, it's much better working environment, right? So the surrogate dependencies, which allows things to go offline, is one of these projects. I thought Docker and containers was one of those, but there's too many moving parts. You're changing too much. So I started with some of those approaches. Hey, let's dockerize the whole thing. And I freaked out too many developers, right? So now I'm going, hey, maybe you should look at Docker, maybe you should look at containers. Let's talk about it exactly, right? But that is a big change. And also it's something that it requires a lot of moving parts. Where this, you can do it even if they don't want to do it. Like, I would argue that as a security professional, you need to do this regardless if the devs want. I have this great stuff where I would do security analysis with the O2 platform, where I'll be like, hey man, where's your attack surface? You know, you have all these stored procedures and you just gave me like, 3 million lines of code and I'm supposed to test that web service. Can you tell me which stored procedures are connected to that web service? Because there's like 700 here, right? And they go like, yeah, good luck, man. If you can find them, we really would like to know too, because we spent hours chasing that shit, right? So then I would create the time, so I spent half the time of the security engagement creating visualizations. And it was great, because when I would present that, I would use it and go like, whoa, how do you do that? Like, well, I just visualize like this. And go, can we use that for development? Like, of course, that's the point. So that's where I learned that if we create tools that we will need to create independently from the development, then we're in some sense. But the offline stuff is really a nice trigger, right? So this is the thing, right? This is what they want, right? This is what we want, and that bit is the cool thing, right? So there's a service, right? There's a dependency. We want to do stuff here. When we talk about SSL and this and that and hardening and all that kind of BS and all that kind of stuff and stuff, yes, it's important. When you hear, it's just freaking noise, right? Even worse is stuff that stops them from delivering, makes them go slower, gives them a headache, right? Here we go. Hey, man, give your 45 findings. There you go, right? Come on, right? Like, 45 check marks, they're all the same thing, right? They need an abstract thing to make sense, right? Or like, you know, find bugs, or even dependency, you know, the OWASP dependency stuff. Like, that is a massive tax, right, into the developers, right? So, you know, if that's being exploited, they'll ignore it, right? So, and here's what I mean by dependency, right? It's anything that is external to the application and developer. Web services, message queues, inbound traffic, other protocols, every freaking thing, right? I'm starting with web services because it's kind of more obvious, it's easier, it's kind of thing to do, but ultimately we want these surrogates for everything. We want these things that look and feel like the real thing, but they're not really the real thing, right? Although they should be, because if they're not the real thing, ultimately it means there's a problem in your unit test, in your integration test to test it, so you're gonna address it, right? So here's the thing, right? Why we do this? Because we want to know what the hell is being done there and there, right? So there's gazillions of vulnerabilities that occur between there and there, between there and there, between there and there. We always struggle as security professionals to be able to test this. Even something as simple as putting a proxy here, right? Just to see that when I hit that service, what happens internally, that just makes your security assessment 10 times more productive. Right? So again, what's the schema of the data flying through? I get to the point where I'm saying, when I do a curve review, I want to look at the web services and I want to stop at the web services, right? At least for injection attacks. I want the first layer of the web services to do all the validation to make sure that anything beyond that, the data is clean. I understand. And if there's going to be injection attack, I want it to be very well cleared and I want to be able to follow it. I want it to be a feature. Fine, you do need to receive unvalidated strings here. Okay, fine. But let's follow it up, right? But then it's one path versus freaking everything, right? So that's what we want to do, right? Again, string is not tied, need to ban strings. And here's the thing, what happens if that guy is malicious, right? Which is again what we're testing here, right? So the key question, what happens is malicious from client, from server to server, and how can we have assurance? One of the things that's really cool is, first of all, how do you prove you have no XSS? Like properly prove, right? Scientifically prove. Right? Well, a nice way is you take every single one of those inputs, you fuzz the hell out of it with XSS payloads, and guess what? That scales because now that's running with milliseconds. So now it's okay to run 1,000 variations on that thing because the request is so quick and you have proof. Right? So now it's a much better way to do it, right? So why I chose Node.js to do this, right? It's because it's JSON native, that is massive, right? It's fast. Is effective testing development. There's some really powerful APIs. JS DOM is just freaking insane, right? In its does, because JS DOM allows you to actually run a full-blown environment, client and server at the same time. So it's pretty powerful, right? So just technology I use, again, so there's JS DOM. You can simulate the browser, supports complex frameworks. So I have some tests in my project where I literally have Node and Angular running in the same space. Right, with all the event loops, with all the complexity, with all the stuff, and the controls, and the directors, and all that jazz firing up, right? And literally I have access to all the Node APIs and everything that's needed, right? And it runs crazily fast, right? That beats any browser integration, any PhantomJS, any Selenium, right? Like, well, again, orders of magnitude, right? And it means that you code it in Wallaby in real time, which once you do it, there's no other way to program, right? Your brain will complain. Right? So, yeah, you know, you can do that kind of stuff, right? So there's Wallaby, real-time code coverage. If you guys, again, not doing this stuff, you know, you're missing the plot, right? So basically, that's the thing. So here's, for example, an integration test that I was talking to that proxy, what you do is you call that server, here's my little saved data, I'm gonna call this guy, right? I'm gonna make the call, I'm gonna get the thing, it has to be a token because I need to get it, I grab it and I save it, and that's it, right? In a way, it's very simple. You just write a whole bunch of these guys, right? And eventually what you do is you're also gonna add a whole bunch of checks for what the data return, but the fundamental part is actually this. So this is the integration test part, right? The content is stored in JSON files, so you can see, here's all the nice JSON, here are all the files, right? And it's funny because you look at this, right? You can already see there's a bit of a salad, right? On the methods, right? And they talk to these guys and go, yeah, because we really would like to have a dedicated service, but we have to use that service over there, right? So you think, I like JSON because it's stored, you can diff it, you can visualize it, you can identify consistent data, you can write tests against the JSON to confirm the schema or the data that you get, right? And you can identify bad data deliveries, for example, multiple requests required, when one should be used, oversupply of data. So this is a massive problem. A lot of these clients, they get given too much data. They give you far too much stuff, right? Again, you have to protect it. If you don't need it, don't send it, right? Or if you send it encrypted, for example, so they don't really need to know it. And you confirm the happy paths, and then we're gonna use that for the injections and other services. Microservices are critical because that's what you do with this. Eventually, the microservice should replace the original surrogate. So the interesting thing about this is the evolution is you first create this, but once they actually have a microservice, you can actually use the real thing. So you can run it locally on Docker, which is great. So instead of actually even mocking that particular service, you actually run the real thing. But if it's a microservice and it's well designed, the real thing would again start in milliseconds, which is really where you want to be, right? So this is, again, is a path to get there, right? And basically, eventually, the microservice might have their own surrogate dependencies. So what you end up having is this ability to create these massive network structures that are actual reality. They actually represent reality versus what the developers thought or an implementation of reality, right? JSTOM, you can do that stuff, testing super fast. This is a module I already had that allows to make requests and see a response. So I did actually want to auto-generate the tests and then easy to create new dependencies. And containers is the key thing, right? So the best surrogates are the real code. The second best is when the surrogates only exist in the second level. And this is kind of the final part of the day, right? And this is very interesting because most of you probably have legacy code, right? And by the way, you should ban that word, especially if that's the one making all the money, right? You should never call an app legacy if that's the one actually making the money, right? Get a better name or else you get this bad feeling and nobody wants to work on that thing. But the key thing is whatever you're working on today, right, whatever code you see today, if that code is already not being planned and already not being kind of mapped to run in a microservices world, right, where you'll be able to run dozens, hundreds of thousands of versions in separate containers, maybe Docker, maybe something else, but containers, right, your code, basically you're not aligned with the next major dev revolution, right? And it's like Git. Again, you are coding in SVN. Right, where Git already is there today. Because the reality is in a couple of years, your app will be as legacy as what you call today legacy, right? Because an app that doesn't farm out requests into multiple things, an app that cannot break your stuff into hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of containers, doesn't really scale. You have to update, you can't have multiple versions running in parallel. It's very legacy from 3 to 5 years from now, right? We're gonna look back and go, whoa, really? Is that how things go? One big project? Whoa, you were deploying a freaking gig? Right? Well, you have 4 terabytes of VMs in your deployment. You know, that is crazy, right? And for the guys who are more enterprise level systems, you probably recognize those patterns, right? So the thing is, right, eventually, and this is where Google gets it right, right? Google fires 3 billion containers a week. And that was a number like from a couple of years ago, right? Everything you do in Google goes on a container. Your vision should be to run every user in a container. And the way you develop that is by all these microservices, is by all these surrogates that allow you to get to that point, right? So again, what's cool about this is you go into development and say, hey, I wanna work on something, which by the way, I'm gonna do regardless if you're gonna do it, but if you work together, it's even better. You can code offline today, I'm pointing you to a better direction and I'm giving you a path for the future, right? That is a very, very strong conversation to have versus, hey man, guess what? I took your app that you wrote for 2 years, I grab a baseball bat, and I just, and isn't that cool how the whole thing collapses, right? And how I'm totally able to own it, left, right, and center, right? And, you know, they have to smile and nod, but, you know, you're not their best friends, right? And of course, they're never going to engage you very proactively, let's say the least, right? So I think it's a much better model for us to work, right? So the XSS project is already there. I want the other code is kind of coming soon. Please be involved, right, on this thing. And again, your devs will love it, and you dramatically improve your testing capabilities. And any questions?
I was very impressed, by the way. But it's okay, I don't need a microphone. But quick question. How many double espressos did you have before you started?
So actually, this is interesting, right?
Go on.
I'm actually doing a coffee detox at the moment.
Oh my God.
So last year I would have like 5 or 6 cappuccinos a day, and I got to the point where I could have a coffee and go to sleep. And I go, well, maybe it's a bit too much.
Well, I'll tell you why, joking aside, the way you're processing and the speed that you have, upon which you're processing and you're taking the flow is quite impressive. So take that as a compliment.
Oh, no, cool, thanks. Yeah. No, I always think it's good.
There was one thing there which sort of flashed, I think, you spotted that one. So, was that a mobile share trading app?
Yeah.
And you actually managed to fake, using cross-site scripting, a delete order, so
correct.
You can actually delete. So someone bought lots of shares, and they actually said, oh, I'm going to delete that order.
Yeah, so in this case, that actually shows that that was not exploitable.
Yes,
because
for a forward.
The app did the right thing.
Yeah.
So what happened in that case is the app built the URL safely in that scenario. And what happened was when they took the data that they got from the server, they used a proper URL builder to create it. But usually, it's very easy to don't really think when you create URLs as with SQL. So what I found these days, I always go to the URL generation because it's literally a hell of an exploit. And if you, for example, you know AWS, if you can control a URL in AWS, you can hit the properties file, you can dump their private key, right? There's all sorts of crazy stuff that exists. But usually the big one is once you can make those kind of calls, you call the next service down, which now completely trusts it, right? So in that case, actually, that's actually a good example. That's not what I showed.
Well, that's the proof, right?
That's the proof.
The point, because you have to demonstrate the proof.
Correct. Yeah, so in that case, what I have is, we have a test, right, that basically calls the site, first injects the payload, calls the site, gets to see the answer that happens from the actual application, and then confirms that today that is fixed. If that was vulnerable, we would write a test that shows that it's vulnerable, so it's passing when literally the payload goes literally transparently, from the client to the server and by the mobile, and then when you fix it, you change that to be a regression test. So that's the flow.
Any more questions, guys?
I did not catch the point, of course, thank you very much for this presentation. I did not catch the point regarding the dynamic data, so for example, cross-site scripting or whatever. So you need to provide dynamic data and you change first the input, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have the responses after the integration just saved locally,
yep.
So how come this will be reflected?
Because what we do, right, so once you have this, right, what we do is we basically start writing tests that start to manipulate that data to inject the payloads and then see what happens there.
So after the integration, because after the integration test, you have the data locally.
Yes, so yeah. the point of the integration test is to give you a suite of happy path data.
Mm-hmm.
So you literally have all the data that is normally requested by that user, right? And the point of this is eventually to reach a level of parity where everything you can do with the app will work like this. Because the moment you've done that is you have all the happy paths. You have everything that the app is supposed to do today, and you have it recorded. And then what we can do is we can basically take those JSON files, and to be honest, like even if in the beginning, right, all you do is do this kind of quasi-manually, that is already a hell of a test, right? Because this happens in real time, right? Because what happens is the replayer is literally loading the things from this, right? The replayer is just saying, for this URL, give back this JSON.
Mm-hmm.
So you can actually change this JSON in real time on this, or a memory, but in my case, I'll change it on this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the next time you trigger that action on the mobile, I've seen a lot of cases with Ajax applications, right? Ajax apps that call the back end you go and trigger the same action, you let the call come through, the payload comes along, and now it pops on the browser.
So it helps only in the heavy traffic. If you need to try, for example, some SQL injection or some new cross-site scripting, it should go to the real server again.
Yes. So the reason why I really like this is because I'm now able to test, in a way, the both sides of the coin, right? So you're able to do the tests where you're hitting the server, right? Mm-hmm. So this is where we hit this. This is where we attack the server, right? So this is where we take those payloads. So this is where we're not interested, in a way, in his one, we're not interested in a response, we're interested in a request. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So what we do is we take the request values, and then we make that. And the reason why this is important, because usually the real vulnerabilities, sometimes the business logic, happen on the third or fourth step of a workflow. So you need to call the first one, then the second, then the third. That's when you can put the payload, because or else the server is not in a state, right, to even be able to process your payload. So you get stuck at the gate.
Mm. Yeah.
So this does the server stuff. This guy does the client stuff. And then you chase the freaking rabbit holes, right? And this is very, very powerful. The one I found the other day was this Twitter guy, where the client guys were implementing a Twitter, right? A little feed, and then we asked, how do you validate that? Oh, you don't validate that. Where'd you get that from? Oh, from that service. Oh, from that service. Eventually, they literally have a full path from a Twitter guy feed all the way to a desktop app, right? Because nobody asked the question, should I validate this, right?
Thank you.
Yeah, that's my question.
So I guess this is useful for API, existing APIs, but if you have a new API that you develop,
yep.
What do you do in that case?
Well, that's even better, right? Because you just start with it. In fact, one of the big lessons I've learned with testing was when I was basically working with an airline, and they were redesigning the whole shopping cart experience, and suddenly there was this thing where the database guys were out of sync with the UI, so the UI guys built one of these. I kid you not. They built a whole test suite to mock the whole database structure, right? So there was a time where they were crazy productive. They were coding very fast because they actually almost don't care about this, right? If you can replay it here, you don't care what happens here, right? Because you have it there. In fact, it's even better because you can go and improve this and then go to the back end and say, hey, you know, this is what I want. But what happened with those guys was as soon as they plugged in the real one, they stopped using the real one, going to bad habits. 6 months down the line, it was out of sync. They couldn't go back because it was too hard work to do this. But I'll give you a better test case. The better test case is when these guys here are creating a microservice. So the real test interesting case is when these guys want to develop a new version, right? At the moment, it's a nightmare because they have to get the backend to support what they want. And it's only when they do it that these guys will go, well, I'm now implemented. And that usually is the first version of what you think you want the backend to give you, right? Which is always wrong. And you might do that loop 3 times if you're lucky, right? What you really want to do is to say, okay, forget about that guy for now, right? Just code away, create the JSONs as you would like the backend to give you, right? Slap that in your microservice. Ideally, maybe write a little proxy so you can generate that if you want to. Then go to the backend and go, hey, can you guys make this official? See the flow? Is so much more productive, right? And you're in control of your world.
Any questions?
I was thinking about Node.js,
yeah,
and all this instrumentation. That seems to be is an external instrumentation. But thinking about Node.js, is it possible to instrument Node.js automatically with an NPM?
Yeah.
So that you can monitor and create the same amount of data about connection between function and methods, not only external calls.
Absolutely.
That would be probably also very useful.
Well, that's already happening. In fact, code coverage does exactly that, right?
Yeah. It was meant to improve the code coverage and see what are the modules called upon a particular call.
Absolutely.
Or a particular
system. So one thing that's amazing when you're programming a Wallaby real-time code coverage role, so Wallaby gives you 2 things. It gives you unit test execution when you lift your hands, which is very powerful. But the really best part is that you see the path of code coverage. So what I've done now is I debug using that, right? Because in a way, the path of the code coverage, where it failed, tells me exactly where it is. What I would love to do is actually exactly what you're saying. I would love to do stuff where you can actually, you know, see the slices, see all the data that gets recorded, right? You know, guys like, what's the guy got? New Relic. You know, it kills me that those guys are sitting on that and they can't just freaking connect the dots, right? Because they have all of it, right? And in a way, it's on their hands, right? But they just haven't connected the dots. Because that is crazy powerful. Because you can do this with the code coverage and then see the paths, right? And then do it, the analysis, literally one by one, right? In fact, what I do with the developers, when you find a bug, so let's say you find a bug here, that is, it's like that one I was talking about there, where you have a SQL injection, I will write a unit test there, then I do a reverse tree. So I'll write a unit test for all the methods that call that guy, then I go up, and eventually, I might find an endpoint that's controlled by the user, right? So you have this thing, but with this, you could actually be more automatic.
There's one more question here from Andrew. So just most of our customers do black box web app testing, which has obviously got its flaws. And you say, you know, white box is the way forward, so I completely agree with that. How long do you think it takes to go from someone who's doing, who's in that frame of mind where it has to be black box, they might have a tiny security team, to the kind of stage that you're at?
You're talking about what it takes from the pen testing company or from the client point?
I think this has to come from inside, but how long would you say it take to drive a company to go from that black box stage through to the stage you're at? Have you ever done that?
I have to deal with that all the time, right? So you talk about the customer, right? So you're the customer commissioning, right?
Yeah.
The best thing to do is to say, you know that black box you have? That is not worth anything. You know, that thing there, right, is actually, you know, what you're doing is you build MetroBank and you ask the John and Smith's detective around the corner to ask you if the thing is secure. So the best you've got, right, is basically what some scripts kids could do, right? And in fact, I would say if those guys with all those limitations, with all those handicaps, right, actually found stuff, then you're in trouble. Because, you know, and then you just present it like this. So you're telling me that you built this thing for 2 years, right? And then you're going to give these guys, right, 1 week if they're lucky, 2 weeks maybe, right? 1 week if they're lucky to understand the freaking thing, get it to run, which is always the first day or two, right? And then find issues, document the issues, like what the hell, right? That is just crazy inefficient, right?
Yeah.
So when I was at ABN AMRO in the bank, we had this thing where we provided a service, pen testing service, and we would call the first one the basic one. Oh, you can have a basic. Oh, absolutely. But you're just giving us an IP address and the login page to an online banking application with no accounts, like true story, right? You go, great, right? You know, we can do a basic test. We run some tools, we do some stuff, we poke on the doors, but this is a basic test. It was named exactly like that. If you give us some stuff, we might do a standard test, right? And then if you give us the code and the developers and access and accounts and all that jazz, we will do a test, right? And that's the thing, we do a proper security assessment. So you want whack them all or you want to do it properly. So what I've done is when you present it like this, and that's why, see, the geo workflow, right, you can't underestimate the power of this. Because what you're doing is you're playing, right, this passive aggressive game, right? So the way this works, right, is you go, oh, I'm doing a pen test, right? So the pen test is a black box. So what we're going to do is I'm going to open a ticket that says the black box test that we're doing is not really worth anything, right? It's basically not a proper test. Can you click here to accept it? So you find that guy who ordered the test is going to swallow hard before clicking that button. Because what you're saying is that you're wasting money, right? And all you have to do, and what I found these days, all you have to do is ask, literally, right? And I found, I remember I was this person going, all right, you guys in the pen test, okay. You're sliding those dots, you don't find stuff. Okay, how we came to the source code? No, I go to the pen test guys. Really good guys, I think we're Sport College, right? Good company, right? I go, hey, have you guys get the code? No. Have you asked for it? No. Come on, right? So can you give them the code? Yes. So basically, like, sometimes all you have to do is literally ask, right?
Yeah.
And I would say that these days, if I'm commissioning a security report, if the guys on the other side are not asking for anything, everything, if the guys on the other side don't say, what we want to do as part of our service is Monday morning, threat modeling, run the app, get the same dev environment, sit with the devs, right? Be there, do code review, right? Then some time in depth to do analysis, for me, they're not playing the game.
You mean, in other words, there's no point in doing it?
I don't think so. No, you know, to put it this way, it's better than nothing, And by the way, if you want to be PCI compliant, that's what you do. Right? So, hey, you know, but so I said that, look, do you want to be compliant? Cool, right? Don't give them anything, right? You know, take your data away, go for it, right? But that's if you want to be compliant. If you want to be secure, we have to do it properly.
Excellent. Thanks so much, Dinis.